The next talk is by Kate Stewart, who is a manager of the PowerPC team at Freescale. And she will talk about a topic which everyone who distributes open source software will find very interesting.
Okay. Hello. Just to give you guys a bit of background, since we were talking about managers recently, I am a manager and have been working in this area for probably about the last 10 years and pretty much took Freescale from the PowerPC side, at least, and started contributing. We're working on the ARM side as well. That is in progress, but trying to get Freescale contributing out and working with the PowerPC architecture into the kernel. So we're pretty much usually reliably one of the top 20 named contributors on the Linux kernel these days and have been for the last couple of years. But we're an embedded company, so we're probably not a big name. However, a lot of our customers have devices that people care about, and as a result, licensing and the copyrights of what we put out is very important in order to let people use these things. So we've been having to, most of the BSPs that we put out, when we put out with the board, a new piece of silicon, people getting a board want something to run on it. So you put a basic Linux distro on it, and you make it available. However, when you're shipping that out, people then sometimes build products right on top of it, so you have to have clean pedigrees. As a result, anytime we're sending software out, we're having to go through it ourselves. And there's a lot of packages out there, and there's a lot of patches that have to get reviewed to make sure your licensing and copyright clean. And so I've been pretty much, me and a couple of other people have been working through most of that for Freescale. And it happened that at the LinuxCon last fall, there was enough of us getting together and comparing notes that it was pretty clear that we're all doing the same thing in different ways over and over again. And so it seemed like maybe it might be a good idea to come together and see if we can come up with a standard for sharing this information, because a lot of the same distros are using these packages. And so one person has to go through a 6,000-line package. Actually, not 6,000-line. That would be nice. 6,000-file package and look at the licensing and copyrights. And then yet another person has to go do it, and so on. So the question is there some way we can share this information and actually put a community together around this? So that's the background here. One of the things I'd just like to figure out is how many people, can I see a show of hands of how many people are working on creating packages in here? Okay, cool. And how many are working on creating distros or doing distros? Okay. Same things. And then others are just interested. Cool. So our basic problem is, okay, we need to figure out what's going on. And so since there's some hands I didn't see showing up, a distro to me is basically a collection of packages, a user space, a kernel, and maybe a bootloader. These are sort of the key elements that will go onto a board support package at this point. And, you know, packages can be anything from applications, user space, libraries, and so forth. So those will be the terms I'll be using pretty commonly throughout this. And, you know, why is this important? Well, like I say, with an embedded company, Freescale. And it used to be Motorola before, and so we've been sort of continuing this on. And realistically, lawsuits happen, and corporations just don't like getting sued for not complying to licenses. Thank you very much. It gets messy. Patents are also a problem, but that's another topic. So our IP, we spend a fair amount of time working with the IP legal teams and so forth on these things. Anyhow, and when we're going through these and putting things together to ship it out, we're finding out that, this package says it's all this license, BSD, cool. Gee, if I go through all those files, one of them's a GPL, That's the contamination issue. Okay, that makes people a little bit nervous. So understanding where we are and making sure we're clean is important. And sometimes this causes some last-minute hiccups. The various distros, the Fedora, the Red Hat, so forth, are very focused on these things because they are doing commercial work. And so some of that influence is coming into a lot of the standards. However, going through a package, and it's a lot of painful time. And so there's tools that help, and there's still some manual that has to happen. So what we need is pretty much, once someone does this work, making it available to others. So let me just go on. So to illustrate this, I'm a big fan of penguins, and I suspect you'll be seeing rocket pictures at some point in time this conference as well. And so this is a penguin colony on Deception Island in Antarctica. And there are 300,000 pairs of breeding penguins here. It's on the outside of this island, rarely get to. And that seems sort of representative to me about the number of packages that are out there these days. And so each of these penguins, you know, it's a rather healthy, vibrant community, and all are contributing differently. So I warn you in advance right now, I'm going to be using penguin thieves to illustrate some of this stuff, since it is conference here. So there are also many different ways of analyzing these packages. The commercial tools that are out there right now, Black Duck has ProTex, and that does allow license scanning, and they do a lot of, if you go to their site, they've got a lot of online information as to what's available and how it can be classified. I've got a couple of stats at the end that are coming from them. And Palomita also has a tool that they're using for this, people can use for this purpose. And then when I was talking to a lot of people at LinuxCon, there's a lot of people with their homegrown tools, and a lot of people with spreadsheets, cross-checking and making sure that everything's good. So the question is, okay, this is all incompatible between these. So what things can we really agree on? And, you know, everyone's having to redo the work. It's a waste. So the proposal is pretty much a two-phase one. First phase is let's figure out what can we standardize on? What facts are there? And make sure it's uniquely identified, as well as agree on, okay, what, make sure that the information that the compliance teams, before they ship out, have it available. It's in a form, you're reading one thing. And you would probably need to make sure it's either human and machine readable, as well as, you know, creatable. So we're looking possibly at some text. So some of these things are areas that are ripe for discussion at this point. And part of the idea is to basically come up with a group that'll work on getting this proposal together. And the seeds of it have started, but I'll get more into that. And the next phase will be pretty much agreeing on a common site where people can post. It'll be on a volunteer basis, so that one team is basically posted, or the author is basically wanting their package to be up and used, maybe they can be providing the information. So right now, the key focus is of getting phase one established, getting the standard template or the format for this information available. And then the next step will be hopefully evangelizing and disseminating and using it. So to put it in perspective, what we're effectively doing is putting banding tags on the packages we care about. So that's a yellow-eyed penguin from the South Island. And if you can see, it's got a banded tag. There's only about 4,000 of them right now in the world. So it's on the verge of being endangered. But a lot of people are caring about what's happening with these birds, so they tag these birds. And what we're talking about here with this is coming up with effectively tags for packages we care about and having a unique association with the information behind. Because that bird's been studied. It's been weighed at some point. It's got its information. It knows, you know, male, female, what's healthy, what's not. So it's effectively a form of tagging. And since I'm in New Zealand, that seemed appropriate. So there's three big sets of package facts to, you know, three categories of package facts. There's our basic identification facts that we need to keep on track of, and that's the metadata. How do you know what your information is? So some of the metadatas are, you know, who's done, you know, what, how do we know this is unique? What the SHAs are and things like that. And, you know, who's done the work? Who's reviewed it? Things like that. They'll give people some degree of credibility on the data you're seeing. Then there'll be properties that are common across the package. So the name of the package is common. The where the main site is, things like that. We can get in there. And then each of the files is where, it's in the details, is where the danger lies. And each file is with the licensing and copyright have, you know, individuals. And people bring things in from all different other places to make the work happen as fast as possible. And that's great for getting something to happen as fast as possible. But if there's unclear attributions and things like that, it causes problems for people who want to use the package. So some of this is to make some of that more visible, so less of the mess is there down the road. Okay. And so I guess to go into some of these areas a little bit more, we need to be able to find the right package. So this is a collection of Gentoos with a chin strap, and so you have to be able to figure these ones out and figure out who you want to be talking to. And so some of that is the authentication. So obviously, when we're putting on the standard, we're going to need to have a version number because we're not going to get it right the first time. That's a given. Things will evolve. And we want to be able to have some degree of compatibility, so getting some versioning in there seems to be pretty key. And then there's going to be a need to be a way of, okay, you've got this package over here, and you've got this information here. How are we going to make sure that, something hasn't changed and we're referring to the right things? So either some sort of SHA or hash mechanism needs to be established. And there's a lot of people who've got brighter ideas than me on this stuff, and I'm hoping that they will help. And then, obviously, okay, we've got this, the information was generated, did someone do it manually, did a tool get used, when was it done? Again, a degree of confidence, a degree of building trust. And then some degree of sign-off or reviewed by, this has worked very well in the Linux community, and basically if one team is basically generating this information and another team's using it, they can sign off that they've verified it and they've cross-checked some things. It'll help build confidence for others. So those are some of the areas I think we need to be looking at for the metadata. In terms of the common package content across the entire package, the things we need to be looking at are, what's the formal name of it? People refer to it different ways. Let's make sure we've got the full name, the version, and some authentic way. What is the package name? Is it a tarball? Is it RPM? What's the name of the download site? Making sure that is uniquely identified. Because these things change. There's usually one site, but sometimes in the mirrors or something. Anyhow, it gets interesting. And then, the standard things, where does it come from, that specific version, and then, what is the licensing in there? And is there alternate licensing available with that package? Just an indicator. Then we can go to the levels of the files and so forth to figure out more, but just a flag at the top level, because most of the time there's a copying statement. And then there may be other things inside. So giving a warning to people that there's more than just maybe what's in the copying statement might be a good idea. And then we're looking at, what's the expected usage? That tends to influence what the rights are when you're working with licensing. And then the formal copyright holder of the packaging itself and the dates on the packaging. Those are all things that the compliance teams tend to look at and are necessary for understanding before we ship. And a lot of the tools out there today will catch a good part of that. And then the stuff that we're not really catching right now is some of the file-specific content. We're doing it a bit. Well, we do it in Freescale in the sense we make sure we're cross-checking our files. But are you uniquely identifying the files, what the licenses are in that file, and what the copyright holders are? That's where things get dicey if there's last-minute surprises before a package is used and shipped out. So making that upfront visible, available to people, is certainly a goal for being able to help with this. And as part of the effort, there's a lot of different ways of referring to licenses out there. So coming up with some appendices that say, okay, these are the common licenses, let's standardize on those, let's all have a common terminology. There's been a lot of efforts in this space already, and through the FOSBazaar and through some of the other organizations who want to be going in this direction. And I think just basically, about 20 of the licenses, according to some of the black ducks, spiders and crawlers, are pretty much counting for nearly all the open source ones. But there's about 80 licenses that have been ratified as open source by the OSI. Coming up with a standard way of referring to them in a short form, some sort of common reference that can be coded up will probably help. And then there's always going to be an other. Some way of basically going to these licenses and pointing to them and making sure that, okay, when we're looking at something, it's common. So why are we going to do that? So the next the idea here is to probably improve the next generation of packages. We've got what we've got today. Hopefully, over time, these packages will be cleaned up, and some of the special cases that are hiding and making people wince and not want to use the packages will go away. And so that is an Adelie penguin with young down in Base Esperanza in Antarctica. So, you know, as we know from the open source side, the more we have public eyes on things, it improves the quality. And this is finally given away. Basically, people don't want to sit there and read through headers on files over and over and over again. It's not exactly the most fascinating thing you can do unless you're a little warped or a legal person. And yeah, I kind of enjoy it sometimes, but there's limits. So, you know, getting the public reviewing and having it such that it's parsable and analyzable in some fashion, I think, will help. Having multiple eyes on it and seeing these discrepancies earlier before people start to use it. The one thing you really, really, really hate is someone pointing out at the last minute before you're due to hit a deadline. This is speaking as a manager. There's a problem over here. This file is this license. We can't ship that. Oh, we've got our stuff built on that. Okay, now what are we going to do? So finding that up early, it helps with managing things and keeping things predictable, repeatable, and setting expectations appropriately and keeping our bosses happy. And then one of the other things is having some sort of neutral forum. So what we have to do is there seems to be a lot, when I'm more and more I've talked to people, everyone's have little case studies of things that they don't want public, but they know it's a risk and they're doing it because, okay, that's what they had to do because they had the deadlines, et cetera. Well, if we have a neutral place to post this information, hopefully some of these things get cleaned up in a way that doesn't point fingers, cause issues. And so the neutral forum, having this neutral forum where this information can be posted is definitely a long-term goal. And obviously making the authors, the individual coders who are working on the packages aware of where they're pulling stuff from, and it could be causing problems. So yes, that's nice and easy piece of code, it's convenient to use and grab. But if you grab it from there rather than grabbing it from somewhere else that has a better licensing, it could cause problems with an end goal. So what are the next steps? There's something that gets referred to as, a friend of mine refers to it as penguin politics. When the penguins are on an iceberg and they want to head off and they want to get off the iceberg and go fishing. Well, usually what happens is they sort of crowd near the edge and then one takes a plunge and goes into the water and hopefully doesn't get eaten. After which point in time, the others decide, okay, it's safe to go in. Well, what's been happening here in this area is John Ellison Esteban Rocket from Motorola took a proposal out to the legal teams in 2008. And it sort of was along this line. So this is building on some of these things. I'm one of those penguins up on the top there, actually, watching what's going on and making sure we've got enough consensus. Yeah, that looks like this. People want to do this. Okay. And basically, it caused a... It sort of hijacked the legal meeting, actually, I was told, in retrospect. And but, like I said, when we met in September at LinuxCon, I met them, and we were talking about this, and I was talking to some legal, and then was talking with a variety of other embedded distros, because I'm coming from the embedded space as opposed to more the desktop. And a lot of us have this problem. And so there seems to be enough of us gathering up on the top, and it looks like the water's clear, so it seems that the groundswell is going. And we talked, hooked up with the Foss Bazaar guys of Martin's here, and it seemed like that was a natural home for this type of effort. So the group has, Foss Bazaar is going to be sponsoring the effort, and we're making a mailing list setting up, and that should be rolling out. But so, you know, hopefully we'll be in the water soon with this standard. So, working group set up. And if you want to participate, either a note to myself or Martin, can get you added to the list. We're still sort of formalizing the governance. I've taken notes from the last talk of things not to do on this one. Thank you very much. And keeping things clean. Like I say, it was a good talk. Very timely. Thank you. The idea being, some sort of electronic and some degree of phone discussions, because sometimes brainstorming does happen better on phone was the thinking, but maybe chat rooms, okay? And then the idea is we've got a sponsor in the legal team, the Linux Foundation, who's willing to work with us once we get the standards figured out to take it to the legal community, cross-check it with them, and then hopefully publish it and start to work with the proprietary companies who are doing this work. So that's roughly the flow that we're looking at for this next year or so. So I guess the next thing is then any questions? Sure. And yes, I'm between you and lunch, so sorry.
So the first things I was thinking about with this is that there already are efforts, a lot of efforts to list the licenses and things.
Mm-hmm.
For example, every Debian package has a full copy of the license of each file already included there, standard prefixes mm-hmm. for what the licenses are. Fedora similarly has the tags that go in the header, and there's some efforts to try and make sure they're actually using the same tags.
Mm-hmm.
So I thought I'd first mention that you really want to be trying to use the same tags that are being used in those other bigger projects that already have most of your software already marked up. And my other thought uh-huh. is that I really don't like the idea of a central database.
I'm not saying a database.
Yeah.
I'm saying a site to post the information. I'm saying, remember, this has got to be machine readable.
Yeah.
And it can be shareable.
Sure. But mm-hmm. my point is,
okay.
information that's not maintained in the package uh-huh. Will go stale quickly, as opposed to you really want the people who have the okay. strongest interest in having uh-huh. the license complied to is the authors of the software. So go that's back good. To them and with... Okay, here we've done some work to mark up your license. You want, we want you to comply with, mm-hmm. with our licenses. I'm an author of Samba, for example. We mm-hmm. you have a real big problem with embedded vendors who don't comply with Samba's license. So we'd be very happy to have in there extra markup that helps mm-hmm. embedded vendor tools find that, yes, this is a piece of GPL software, these are the rules, these are the other files are under slightly mm-hmm. more other permissive licenses we include for various reasons. Mm-hmm. We'd be more than happy to have that stuff in the tree. We probably would try and auto-generate that file as much as we could because we want to keep it maintained. Auto-generation is the biggest thing you want to do.
Mm-hmm.
So maybe coming back with projects and saying you, for example, not used the standard FSS copyright header, you for some reason have re-indented or something, and here is a carefully reviewable patch that just means that it all matches the standard mm-hmm. regular expressions, things like that. Those kind of things would really help us ensure that we've got software that is easily reviewable,
mm-hmm.
and because we've got the biggest interest in having our license complied to. We're the ones insisting on it.
Okay.
And so you should never, don't try and do this aside from mm-hmm. the upstream projects that are around, because, and other than that, talk to us. And if you're in a spot with our software and mm-hmm. you've shipped it out the door, talk to us.
I do. Okay.
So, and that's the biggest thing. Like you were saying, your neutral Kabul sort of, won't be poking any fingers. It's actually just going back to those upstream projects that you've infringed. Sort of.
It is, but some of the upstream projects that people aren't, you can't find anymore.
Yeah.
Okay,
yeah.
So I'm not precluding that, and actually I support that. Okay,
yeah.
What you're saying is if the package authors want to be pulling this information in, keeping it, carrying it with their package, making sure there's a unique identifier, yay.
And
as far as I'm concerned, it's yay.
And if you can't find a maintainer for it, find
right.
somewhere like Debian that will keep it,
mm-hmm.
and then always make sure you grab your stuff, say, from Debian's packages, because they're always worried about this kind of stuff anyway. The whole mailing list full of people worried about this stuff.
Yeah, I've been talking to Thomas Gleixner and a couple of other people on this whole subject, and they're supportive of what sort of we're talking about here with this, trying to get to the more level of the details. But, what we're saying is basically, what we're coming up with here is, here's a format for sharing and changing the information. Where it gets placed... no limitations, as far as I'm concerned.
I think the actual packages, I just would worry that a site would get stale.
Yeah.
And you'd think that, Samba's still GPL v2.
Uh-huh.
And things like that, where we change the license.
Remember, too, though, that
you are doing
each
a
time,
version and things.
Each time you come up with a new version of a package, there's one set of data that has to be looked at. So it's unique. So it isn't so much stale, so much as things that are not being used anymore.
Yeah. The
okay? Because you want the one-to-one correspondence always between a package and its data.
Yeah.
And so that's it. But that's good input. Thank you.
Okay.
And maybe
my screensaver went up.
if I can just
that's
comment.
A whole set of Antarctica shots actually, so okay.
If I can just comment on that as well, I think mm-hmm. the goal is definitely to eventually get this upstream. I mean, so I work for HPE's open source program office, and so we deal with that when we ship open source. We need to know every license. You can't just say, well, it's mostly GPL. And there are some other odd licenses. If you distribute the code, you need to follow every license, and so you need to know every license. So we actually created a tool called Fossology, and it's open source, which goes through the source code, which looks for license headers as well as license references. So this code is distributed under the GPL. But that's, it's, you know, it doesn't find everything. I mean, it's a good tool, but it's not magic. You still need to go through some of the stuff by hand. And so ideally, what would happen is if every open source project would simply distribute a file, and it could be in that standard, which would just say, you know, what the licenses are, what the copyright are, but do that in a file which every open source project uses and which is actually machine possible. And that's the, I think, the long-term vision. Obviously, it's going to take a while to get there. But I think, and we have some good partners like the SFLC who projects listen to. And I think the next step, once we have some idea about what kind of standard we could use, would be to work with some projects which care about licensing, like KDE, Debian, Fedora, Samba, and try to get it implemented. And then we can show projects, it works, and try to get it adopted widely. I think that's one of the ideas, but it's really a very new effort.
This is a new effort, and it's looking for members who feel passionate about these issues. So.
And we definitely know about the efforts. I know that Debian, I'm a Debian developer, mm-hmm. so that there has been a proposal about a machine possible file because the current, you were going to say that? Because the current Debian copyright file has the same problem. It contains all of the information, but you can't parse it. So there has been a proposal, and we need to look at that as well. So any other comments, any questions?
So speaking as an upstream mm-hmm. developer rather than a package maintainer for a distro for the moment, I would really love to be able to include this information in a machine repositible format. So as a small request, if you can make it so that it's very painless for an upstream author to do include mm-hmm. this in every file, that would be increased adoption rate dramatically, I think. Yeah. Yeah, and if you can provide a tool to make sure that it's correct, and uh-huh. every time someone modifies the file, then it screams if it doesn't.
Yep, if it's going to be both machine and human readable, there needs to be a checker. Yeah, that's clear.
And small.
Mm-hmm. The question is, yeah, we can help. Okay. That's going to put. Okay, any more questions? Well then, enjoy lunch. Thank you.
Okay, thank you.